We showed you Jeffrey. Let's meet Jeffrey and Bonnie and George and Bree and Guy, and the whole Ellis family is coming to join us a little bit. Who should I talk to? Bonnie, you want to talk a little bit?
Sure.
Okay, let's stand up and ask Jeffrey to join us. Now, the one thing you have to realize, it doesn't matter if he squalls or grabs the microphone or pulls your necklace off. It doesn't matter. Okay. Sometimes, you know, mothers get very nervous. They think, well, he's not behaving. Doesn't matter. Tell us about what Jeffrey had.
He was diagnosed with a severe immune deficiency called Wiskott-Aldrich, and he was diagnosed...
Wiskott-Aldrich.
Wiskott-Aldrich. It's very rare. You know. Mm-hmm. I think there's only been 400 diagnosed cases in hundreds of years. And what he had was severe eczema, severe allergies. He had low platelets, which meant he bled easily, and he was prone to a lot of infections.
Well, he's still a tiny baby now, and he's only 14 months old. Right. How young was he? I mean, when these things started showing up...
Two weeks.
This was your third child. You had the other two we'll meet in a minute. So instead of having the nice little let's take baby home from the hospital experience, you had a lot of anxieties and concerns.
He never slept. Yeah, he had lots of problems. Right.
And what did they do first? I guess they must have thought it was something else at first, didn't they?
Well, they just thought it was severe eczema. Mm-hmm. Right. So it didn't take them long, though. We went down to Rainbow's, and they diagnosed it within several weeks. After, because I kept saying, it's just not a normal baby. I've had two, and he's not right. And they did some blood testing and immediately diagnosed it at 6 months.
Dr. Kosher, how can you, if there's only been 400 cases ever, how could you identify something so quickly? The signs that clear?
Well, Jeffrey had a package of symptoms of eczema, severe skin rash, and low blood platelets, and a number of tests that demonstrated that he did not fight infection well, that were very typical of this rare disorder that affects infants called Wiskott-Aldrich.
It's not cancer, though, exactly.
No, it's a disorder of the immune system that there's no cancer cell there, but it's a severe disease which in many cases is very, very rapidly fatal. Mm-hmm. And in the last 5 to 6 years, it's been found around the country that this could be treated successfully with bone marrow transplantation. Jeffrey's probably only about the 10th child that has had a bone marrow transplantation for this disease. And Jeffrey is probably the youngest child in the world that's ever had a bone marrow transplant for this disease.
And well, that's a pretty tough thing to go through just to get on television, Jerry. I frankly don't think I would have done it.
As you can see, he's pretty much completely cured.
That's great. And that's a final statement, isn't it? I mean, the thing that was wrong with him when they did the bone marrow transplant, you got rid of the bad stuff and put the good stuff in.
Right. We gave him bone marrow from his sister, Bree, who's sitting there next to him.
Okay, Bree, you want to stand
now
up for just
a minute? Bree's bone marrow. And
one of the problems with being 7 years old is even when you stand up, you're still not real tall, are you? Now, this treatment that you had came after they did some tests, didn't it?
Mm-hmm.
What kind of tests did they do?
Blood tests.
They took blood out of you?
Mm-hmm.
Did it hurt?
Yes.
Did you go to your mother and daddy and say, I've had enough of this, I don't really want to do this anymore?
Yeah.
Tell the truth. Did you?
Well, I really didn't like them.
Yeah, I don't like them either. I don't know whether I would have had the courage to do something like that. I would have been frightened, the whole idea. Were you a little bit frightened?
Yeah.
Yeah, I can imagine. As they did it, did they put you to sleep?
No.
They did? Didn't they put you?
For
the bone marrow transplant.
Yeah.
They did, didn't they?
Mm-hmm.
That is frightening. I would have been afraid of that. What did they tell you ahead of time? Did they tell you before they put you to sleep anything about what they were going to do? And
yes.
Who told you?
Anne.
And she told us a little about what she does. So really, then she came to see you and she talked to you about it? Was it, and you understood it? I mean, she was able to talk about it in such a way that you could understand it. That's great. You realize that what you gave Jeffrey is probably curing.
Yes.
That's kind of neat, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
I think so, too. Now, let's meet Guy. Guy? How old are you?
Five.
You've been sort of on the sidelines on this. I mean, you really had to wait while all of this stuff went on, didn't you? Are you glad it's over?
Yeah.
I guess so. I guess everybody's glad it's over. Everything get back to normal now, right? What do you like to do the most?
I don't know.
Like to play outside? Oh, we'll let you go inside in just a few minutes. You're in, what are you in, first grade? What grade are you in school?
Nursery
school. You're big. I thought you might be six. You're not that old. Okay. Let me meet your father. Let's just sit down. Hey, George. George, you want to stand up just for a second? One of the things that I wanted to talk to you a little about was the enormity of something like this to an average person.
Yeah.
I mean, when you're minding your own business and all of a sudden this becomes a part of your life when you never expected to have to deal with anything more than all of us deal with on a regular basis. What kinds of things go through your mind? I mean, the why me, I guess, first. But after that, what do you do? Put yourselves in the hands of the experts and just do what they say?
We did a lot of investigation. You know, we talked to Dr. Kosha. We also talked to the National Institute of Health.
That's over in Bethesda.
That's in Bethesda, Maryland. And we did it to make sure in our own minds that we checked out the diagnosis, the treatment, checked it out as well as we possibly could.
People in the audience have to be thinking, you know, what if they were wrong and this family went through all this? I mean, I can see that you really want to know that what they're telling you is right, particularly when it's something so rare.
Yeah, I guess we didn't doubt the diagnosis. You know, the more we talk to people, and we have some medical texts of our own, and the symptoms were there, and that's what it was.
So you thumbed through and looked it up and read about it?
Oh, yes.
Just as the parent trying to figure out, you know, what if these doctors were really giving the right scoop.
Yeah.
Now, was Jeffrey, when he had the operation, what did they do to him? Were you allowed to be there or not?
Oh, yeah. In fact, they did it. He spent the 7 weeks in the hospital in a little isolation booth, and the transplant was actually given to the marrow was given to him in the booth. It's just a bag hung just like giving blood or whatever. But the procedure, you know, that's anticlimactic, the putting in the bone marrow. It's the 2 weeks, you know, before that where you're going through the drug therapy to kill the existing marrow.
Did Bree have to go through that too or not?
No. No, Bree was only in for a day and a half in the hospital.
Did you ask the doctors, couldn't they use yours instead of hers?
We were all of us tested a number of times to make sure, you know, who was the right match. And Bree was the one that came out the match. And we're very thankful that there was, because there's no guarantee that there's going to be a match in your family.
Anybody can match.
Right. And then after the transplant, there was 2 to 3 weeks where we waited to see the results. Did it take? And that was a long time.
Well, congratulations. Everything worked out, and you've got a family now that has more than just your normal amount of blood relationship, I guess you'd have to say. These are the Ellises. We're going to take a quick break and come back, and Paul McDonald's going to join us, too, later on from the Cleveland Browns, who's involved in one of the voluntary programs and trying to make things a little better for the children. We'll meet Paul and do a lot more when we come back right after this.